Not moving.
Blew all night.
But it blew all night and blew all around the way down, and the roads were perfect on Friday. And what we could see of the roads today were good, but it was good. Anyway, not to complain, but we have a different format this morning. It's going to be a lot of singing, and I'm going to intersperse some of the scripture reading in amongst the hymns for a little while. At communion, we're going to be bringing our harvest offerings up, because we weren't here last week, as well as our regular offerings. Also, I don't know if any of you have, that's interesting, I didn't keep talking from my phone. I don't know how many of you have heard anything on the, on the news. It seems to be one of those headlines that they enjoy offering up with a slight smirk, some of them, but the New York Times, of all papers, being liberal friends of some of us, I had a report this week that the Methodist Church was split for sure, and it was going to be just all this crisis coming along. And this morning, or yesterday morning, I got a letter from Randy Cross, who says, if you read the paper, and then he says, nothing has happened at all yet. It won't happen until May. And if the church splits, it splits. And that's sad, but it's not the end of the world either. But this little story has popped up time and again. And so I printed his letter for you if you're interested in looking at that. It's just one of those things that when you're having problems anyway, it doesn't help to have a lot of people running around pointing out. Okay, so you're gonna decide probably to have a real potluck.
See what happens if we just have a talk instead of
I was at First Church in Sioux Falls for a year. We had an Advent decorating thing, and I said we're going to do the decorating in the afternoon, and we'll have a potluck there. Senior pastor, who I'd known for a long time, and I said, "Well, now who's going to organize this potluck dinner?" So you just announce potluck dinner. People bring stuff. It works. Oh, he said, "How can that work?" I said, "Just trust me. It works." So we did, and it did. But it was just kind of funny because he'd been in the church a lot longer than I had, and I he was close to retirement when I started out, and he should have known better. It was kind of fun though. Anyway, so this is going to be you think this is going to be where everybody brings something?
I think so. Well, we haven't really.
We got a few weeks yet.
Yeah.
Well, just keep us posted.
We'll have some. We'll have some.
Okay. All right, a little explanation. I had a note I was going to make about, I guess we'll just go through the format here and see how it goes. But before we do any of that, let's stand and take a few moments to greet and welcome each other to this time.
Sound guy, so.
Oh,
but I know he always, the one we had always before, always appreciated the fact that he did a sound check.
Right.
So we'll probably try.
I'm going to go first.
21, verses 1 to 3, and the first verse of We Three Kings.
What?
219,
Bob.
19?
Yeah.
219. Sorry. Somebody tell us what it is, but currently going on. Have the right number, 250? I think so. change of seasons and the promise of new opportunities, and we enjoy the holidays if we keep them in perspective and don't let them wear us out. But they do sometimes, and we travel and we discover things that are more ideal when we think about them ahead of time than they are when they happen. Still, we're thankful for the times of celebration in our lives. We also are acutely aware
Come from the glorious kingdom.
they returned to their country by another route. Maybe they were wise then. They must have suspected. Maybe that little wee voice in the back of their head was, you know, this Herod just doesn't come off as being quite the way you have us think. One of the things I've discovered, the older I get, is to not take myself so seriously. I'm trying to remember when I ever did. I mean, it goes way back, but I've been getting older for a long time, since I was born, for example. It's like the guy that says, "Have you lived here all your life?" And the old guy says, "Well, not yet." Time is a relative thing. But so there are stories, and you may have caught on by this time, that I just love to tell more than once. For example, 4 days after Christmas, 1998, I was working in the basement of the house about 100 yards away from the church, and Kathy says, "Jack, you better get up here." It was just shortly after Christmas. I said, "What? Get up here." So, okay, I went upstairs. And we lived about two blocks from the fire station on the north side of our place, and the church was just to the south of us. He said, "You better look out over at the church." So I went and looked, and the church was on fire. I thought, well, that's a good cause to get worked up. So I got my jacket and ran over there, and my moccasins and my jacket. And our neighbor, who was a reporter for the KFGO, was parked in our parking lot. So he says, "As soon as you're ready, you can come sit in the truck." He says, "It's too cold to stand around out here." It was really cold. It was about 25, 30 below that. Anyway, it almost destroyed the entire church. We discovered that when you have a fire and all the smoke you have, that all your electronics are gone. And so it was a big thing. A reporter came in, and I had my office across in the daycare, which had moved out until we were ready to reinstall everybody in. And it was in a closet in the daycare. It's about 6 by 6 and had this huge window. I thought, well, this is not a bad thing. It's quiet. And I can act like a baby, and people wouldn't be surprised. After all, it's a daycare. But anyway, I was over there, went back over to the regular office, which hadn't been really touched by the fire or the smoke. And I was sitting in there, and a reporter came in from KFGO, and one of the questions that she asked was, "Don't you wonder why me, why us, why the church? You know, why would we have a fire?" I mean, she didn't actually say it this way, but this is a house of God. Who would dare set fire to this place, you know? Anyway, and my answer was, no, actually not. This is a building, like any business or someone's house, it could burn. Oddly enough, we had just raised our insurance in October to full coverage. It was only $75 more a year. And I thought, if these guys don't go for this, I'm going to pay it myself. It's crazy. So I asked him, well, why is it so little? He said, "Of all the churches I insure, this is the least likely to ever get a fire." So here we were. It's a building, and like anything, it can burn. It's interesting how some folks seem to think that God must protect churches more than other places, like Notre Dame in Paris, or our nation more than others, our loved ones first. That year opened our eyes to the reality, universality of suffering. I had a friend in college, his name was Daryl Leach. He was a year ahead of me. We were born the same year, but he was a little older, a few months. He was also a United Methodist pastor. In 1997, he was told that he had cancer, and he had brain surgery 3 different times. Took early retirement in 99 at the age of 57. Someone asked him the same question. Why wasn't he angry at God for putting him through a year of illness, resulting need to face his own mortality? He says, "You know, I don't ask that question. I ask, well, why not me? I mean, I'm not any different than anyone else. People get sick. People die. I'm no better than any of them, and I expect no partiality from God. Life isn't fair, isn't balanced. philosopher said one time, if I accept sunshine and warmth, then I must also accept the thunder and the lightning. It's part of the package. I was an avid Peanuts fan since they started, I think. And one of my favorite little inserts on the Daily Peanuts comic strip was Lucy had this little advice stand, like a lemonade stand. I think, what was the advice? 5 cents? Or 2 cents? Or something like that. And Charlie Brown's sitting in front of his elbow on the counter there. She says, you know, Charlie Brown, it just isn't fair. Life just isn't fair. I don't like it when things don't go well. And he's giving her advice, and he says, well, you know, life has its ups and downs. And she said, I don't want any downs. I just want ups, and I want more ups, and I want more ups, and more ups. Well, who doesn't? I mean, it's just what you want, but you don't always get what you want. So here we are once again at the beginning of a new year. The time thing has always been kind of an interesting thing to me. It's you know, how we divide time up. And it's kind of like that little question somebody asks, you know, if you didn't know how old you are, how old would you be? I haven't thought about it that way. You're always told how old you are. But how old would you be? How different would New Year's Day be if it wasn't, you know, if you actually woke up in the middle of February and you thought it was New Year's? I mean, what difference does it make? So we're in the beginning of a new year, and in our gathering we reflect on the visit of the Magi, wise men who recognized the presence of God and Jesus and gave homage to him. It's a beautiful story. This child born among humble folk, praised by shepherds, angels, and the wisest of men. Often in the midst of the seasonal warmth of our Christmas celebration, we may forget the thunder and lightning that surrounded his ministry. We don't know of Jesus because he was born a cute little, no crying he made, baby in a manger in Bethlehem, provided by an innkeeper who had no room, but he was a nice guy and he gave him the space. We don't remember him for that. We remember him because he raised hell and got killed for his efforts. And somebody said he didn't die on an altar between two brass candlesticks, but on a garbage heap on the outside of town. Hung up naked between two thieves, ridiculed, left to die. Forget the thunder and the lightning, the confrontation, persecution, arrest, rejection, crucifixion. Without the ministry and sacrifice of the adult Jesus, we know nothing of the birth of him as a child in a manger. And there are people who say, well, you know, I don't think it really happened that way. Well, so what? It's a good story. It might have happened that way. Maybe it did. I like to think it did. Doesn't make me any less intelligent. Doesn't make me any more knowledgeable. It's just a neat package to be unwrapped as we grow up and move through our lives. The wise men were changed by their meeting Jesus and went back to their lands in a different way. Jesus' life went a different way than carpentry as he began to realize who he was. Let's talk about a career change. Sometimes it's the lightning and thunder and storms of life which cause us to go different ways than perhaps we intended. The faith we share is the same. It's beautiful. It offers us a great deal of comfort and joy, but it's a call as well, a call to witness in a way that can be uncomfortable at times. One that makes no promises that because we believe we'll not suffer. We can fail, we can become ill. can die, we can suffer fire and storm, but none of this is the handiwork of God, and none of it is the end. It's the world we live in. We're strong, and we go on, and we do so because we have the support of many others of God's children all around us and far from us. And we have the promise of Advent and Christmas that God is with us, and that we're never alone. And for that, I always say, thanks be to God. Thanks be to God. To whom I say, Eternal God, help us to be ready to risk our pride and our self-interest in the effort to seek out your Son, as did the wise men. And after finding him once again, to follow him, and let our priorities be set by his standards and not ours alone. In his name we gather. Okay, I have it on good authority that the next hymn is in the bleak midwinter. I have it also on good authority that it's number 221. It's printed right out of the hymnal. And it's got four verses, and we're going to sing them. So let's stand and do that. Plate in the front for your offerings today if you have them and wish to have a body given for you. Eat this in remembrance of me. When the meal was over, he took the cup and gave thanks to you for it, and gave it to them, and said, "This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Drink this in remembrance of me." Give us confidence, O God, that we ourselves might know you and know each other better in the breaking of bread and in the sharing of the cup. Holy Spirit of God, sanctify this food for our salvation and unite us through this bread and unfermented juice of the grape into one body.